Hello, I'm very happy to welcome you virtually inside this very special room within the Palace of the Louvre, the Museum of the Louvre, that is unfortunately closed for now, but we hope to welcome you physically very soon. Meanwhile, we will do this brief tour with me, Ariane Thomas, Director of the Ancient Near Eastern Antiquities Department, and also curator for the Mesopotamian collections. And this is where I welcome you virtually, here in the core of the Mesopotamian galleries, the so-called Cour Sabbat Court, in which you can visit an evocation of a very huge ancient city, the ancient Assyrian city called Cour Sabbat in its modern name and Dur Sharrukin in its Assyrian name, an enormous city in which you had a huge royal palace in the honor of its king and founder, here behind me, Sargon II, who reigned over Assyria and the Assyrian Empire, which means a large part of the Near East, in the end of the 8th century, before Christ, of course. From Assyria, we jump back in the past to the second millennium BC, here in the 18th century before Christ, with a very famous Mesopotamian king and one of our masterpieces, which is the codex of the Babylonian king Hammurabi, whom you can see here on the top of the stela in front of the god Shamash, the sun god, who's enthroned and giving its power to the Babylonian king. Hammurabi tells us that he's a king of justice, and this is a tradition that will then be adopted by many kings, including in the Bible, of course. Let's think of Solomon. And here you have a very long text written in Babylonian language and cuneiform script, giving something like 300 examples of justice in many, many fields, so that just as clearly states Hammurabi, one seeking for justice can just go in front of the stela and take the example of the very wise Hammurabi, king of justice. From the 18th century, we then find here a king who reigned in the 22nd century before Christ. We are now in the Neo-Sumerian period in the south of Iraq, in a kingdom called Tello, and its prince here was Gudea of Lagash. Unfortunately, we can't see its head, but we are lucky enough in our collection to have a few other statues of Gudea, among which some have their head. Here you can see Gudea in praying, the joined hands in front of him, and he's sitting with a long script in Sumerian language this time, still in cuneiform script, as a prayer to his main god, Ningirsu, telling also about the fact that he completely rebuilt the main temple of Ningirsu in its kingdom. And not only he does describe this main work, but he has on his knees the tablet, the evocation of the clay tablet, with the drawing of the ideal map of this temple and the tools he should have used to do this drawing on the clay tablet for real. So here, Gudea is really the king praying its god and recalling us its work as a builder king. Here we are in front of another masterpiece of the Mesopotamian collection in the Louvre. This is the stela of Naram-Sin, Naram-Sin being a king of Akkad in the 23rd century before Christ. Naram-Sin here celebrates his victory over people from the Zagros mountain between Iraq and Iran nowadays. Those people are called the Lulubi, and you can see the mountain where he was victorious over them. the soldiers thanks to which he was victorious, but also the gods over there, and they were even more before the stela was somehow damaged over time. And the gods are, of course, another way, another support, essential support for Naram-Sin. Still, Naram-Sin, for the very first time in history, does present himself with some horn over his head that is the very symbol of the divine power. So it does mean that Naram-Sin was divinized for the very first time during his own reign. And that is also confirmed by the very, very tiny remain of the Akkadian inscription over here, where we can see what we call a determinative sign showing that there is the symbol preceding divine names before his own names, Naram-Sin. Here we are in front of a very important piece of our collection, and I would say even on a very large historical point of view, since up today, it is considered as the very first monument known to celebrate a historical event through the text and the image. You can see remains of the cuneiform script writing Sumerian language here, and of course what remains from the stela, that is a victory stela of the king Eannatum, king of Lagash, a Sumerian king from the 25th century before Christ. This is a double-faced stela. On the other side you can see the god who supported the victory of Eannatum, and here you can see Eannatum four times on the fourth register. Of course, some here we can't have much except his hand, but we can see him with his troops victorious over the people of Umma. Umma was a very close kingdom, the neighbor of Eannatum in the south of modern Iraq. And Umma here is completely defeated. This also gives the name to the stela, especially here when you can see the deaths of Umma and the vultures taking their head and their heads and remains. So this is also the nickname of the stela, so-called the stela of the vultures. Here I presented you some of our main masterpieces about the historical period of ancient Mesopotamia. This historical period starts with the invention of writing in the end of the fourth millennium, and that's why the oldest piece I present dates back to the third millennium BC. We are lucky enough to have many other pieces, and also much older, prehistorical especially, but I won't present it here. Those pieces maybe will be presented in another occasion. That's also for me an opportunity to not only say goodbye this time, but please, you're more than welcome on our social networks, websites, and any other events that we do for you while we cannot yet physically welcome you in our galleries, and hopefully this will be soon possible.